Everyone, I'm Dr. Shannon Zink, Director of the National Institute of Nursing Research, and I am so pleased to welcome you all to NINR Director's Lecture on Population and Community Health. Today's event is the last in a series of webinars that we've been hosting to provide an in-depth look at each of the research lenses in our 2022-2026 strategic plan, which we launched in May of last year. Next slide, please. First, I'd like to remind everyone that today's lecture will be recorded and made available through our website, ninr.nih.gov. Closed captions are available and may be enabled at the bottom of your screen. Next slide. So now I'll begin today's webinar by telling you a little bit about NINR's strategic plan. At NINR, we are committed to leading nursing science to solve pressing health challenges and inform practice and policy, optimizing health and advancing health equity into the future. Our mission statement reflects our belief that nursing research is the key to unlocking the power and potential of nursing. And our strategic plan describes how we want to leverage the strengths and unique knowledge and perspectives inherent to the discipline to the benefit of all people. Next slide, please. The plan includes five research lenses that we think will help nursing science to innovate, think bigger, and greatly increase our impact. Now, when we say lens, we're describing a perspective through which to examine a health challenge. The lenses in the strategic plan are health equity, social determinants of health, population and community health, prevention and health promotion, and systems and models of care. One of the distinct aspects of nursing practice is that it extends from individuals to entire communities and populations. So today's webinar will focus on the population and community health lens. Next slide. Throughout the webinar series, we aim to help nursing researchers better understand and apply NINR's research lenses to their own work. We had three learning objectives for the series. First, we wanted to provide a forum for discussion on how nursing research can help address our nation's most pressing health challenges. Second, we wanted to provide examples that illustrate the possibilities for scientific inquiry through NINR's research lenses. And third, we wanted to discuss practice and policy implications of nursing research through each of NINR's lenses. So you can use the Q&A module to ask questions at any time during the webinar. We will, though, hold questions until the end and try to get to as many as we can. We're also pleased to offer continuing education credits for today's webinar. So stay with us until the end for more information and a QR code to scan to obtain credits. Next slide. I am delighted that we have two distinguished speakers with us today to talk more about research through the population and community health lens and implications for policy and practice. So in the interest of time, I'll give brief introductions, but more complete bios are available on our website. Our first speaker is Dr. Sarah Stoddard from the University of Michigan. She is an internationally recognized nurse scientist with expertise in adolescent health and experience in research on the efficacy and effectiveness of multifaceted community-level interventions aimed at prevention of violence and substance misuse. Dr. Stoddard was appointed by the CDC to serve as a member of the Community Preventive Services Task Force, an independent non-federal panel of public health and prevention experts that provides recommendations and findings on programs, services, and other interventions to protect and improve population health. Our second speaker is Dr. Paul Kuehnert. He is the president and CEO of the Public Health Accreditation Board, the national nonprofit that sets standards and accredits local, state, tribal, territorial, and U.S. Army governmental public health departments. In his role, he leads the strategic direction of the board as it strives to advance and transform public health practice through performance improvement, strong infrastructure, and innovation. Dr. Stoddard and Kuehnert, welcome. We are so pleased that you could join us today. Dr. Stoddard, I will turn things over to you to get us started.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Zink. I'd like to thank Dr. Zink and the planning committee at NINR for the invitation to participate in this lecture series. My nursing career, both as a practicing nurse and now in academia, has focused on community and population health, and I appreciate the opportunity to share my perspectives. Today, I plan to start by providing some grounding in community and population health, provide two examples from my own research, and end by posing some ideas for future directions within this lens. Socioeconomic factors and the physical environment exert a stronger influence on health than individual health behaviors or even access and quality of health care. Studies show that 40% of an individual's health is determined by social and economic factors, such as education, occupation, income, family and social support, and community safety. 10% is determined by one's physical environment, such as air and water quality, housing, and transit. 30% is determined by health behaviors, such as diet, exercise, and substance use. Finally, 20% is determined by their access to healthcare and the quality of that care. We also know that social determinants of health and their effects are not equally distributed, and certain populations are disproportionately affected. The first session in the speaker series focused on social determinants of health, and I highly recommend viewing the recording for a more in-depth of the social determinants of health. But what we do know is understanding and addressing social determinants of health are critical to improving health and reducing health disparities. But how do we do that? How do we address these factors? If the greatest contributors to health are related to social and economic conditions and the conditions in which we live, work, and play, we need to move from an individual person-centered focus to take a more ecologic perspective. So those of you may recognize an ecological kind of framework or model. There's a number of different versions of this basic model. I've used Bruffenbrenner's kind of systems kind of labeling for it. But what we know and how we use this is that the individual is in the center of the concentric circles. And all these kind of systems and processes that surround the individual influence their health and health behavior. And I study adolescents, and so also kind of their development. So when we think about that, we're thinking about these kind of factors that are most directly influencing the individual, but also moving out into factors within the community. So kind of laws, crime, kind of transportation, social services, kind of those factors within the community that an individual may or may not have access to. And then factors within the microsystem or society, and sometimes people label this policy, but to me, this is broader than just policy. It's culture, it's social norms, it may be like systematic racism, it's politics, it's those bigger societal factors that influence the way we think, and can influence our health and health behavior. So factors at the community and societal levels contribute to the social determinants of health, and that's really where the social determinants of health sit. So to me, the population and community lens focuses on those factors at the community and societal level. So I pose a question: how might we change factors at these levels to improve health or improve health equity? So when we think about community and populations, I also want us to think about and talk about what we mean by that. And so I think defining that up front, at least for the conversation today, is important. So to me, a community or population is a group or an aggregate of people. And that might be by some similar characteristics. A number of factors can kind of define what a community or population might be, and that might be related to their health or a health condition. That might be a geographic boundary, like a community, a neighborhood, a city. It could be race, age, faith. So all those kind of different kind of aspects are ways that we can think about populations or communities. It's also important, I think, that we think about what we mean when we say population health then as well. So just take a second and think about what you think about when you are looking for a definition of population health. So there are several definitions out there, and there's discrepancies in what we mean when it comes to population health. I'm going to use the definition today that includes a description of health outcomes within a population, the determinants that influence that distribution, and the policies and interventions that impact the determinants. So population health holds that there are a wide range of determinants of health and well-being, many of which lie beyond the reach of healthcare services, that determine the health of populations, and emphasize on reducing inequities in health, as well as improving health overall. And those are things that are core to a population health approach. So this figure depicts kind of that definition. Population health is about understanding how policies, programs, and practices influence the health status of individuals and communities. So, and we're interested in the mechanisms through which those policies, programs, and practices influence those outcomes related to morbidity, health-related quality of life, and mortality. And we know that within morbidity, mortality, and health-related quality of life, that there are significant disparities. And so it's important to kind of have an eye and consider those as we're thinking about population health. So I kind of think about this figure in two ways. First, I think about it is, what are current or maybe historical programs, policies, and practices? How have they influenced determinants and factors which then produce our current health outcomes? Alternatively, you could think about what are new or different policies, practices, or programs that can result in changes in health determinants and factors to then produce health outcomes that might be improved health outcomes and potentially change health disparities and foster health equity. Policies can be implemented at many different levels of the ecological model that we just looked at. It can be at an individual level within an individual school or an individual workplace, but it can also be at a state level or a national level. There's an increasing call for health and all policy approaches. And you likely heard that term. And the idea is that it underscores the fact that health implications are really tied to many, many policies, even those that aren't maybe directly about health. Programs aimed at population health improvement are extremely diverse and address the full range of health determinants and factors. To have a greater impact, we need to move beyond thinking about only improving access to care and individual behavior and move to these higher level social and environmental factors. So population level approaches focus on more of these upstream factors. You might recognize this figure from the Future of Nursing document. And within the Future of Nursing document, they also speak to population approaches as being poised to act on upstream social determinants of health or the underlying causes of health problems that apply to a large number of people. So while we're discussing social determinants of health and population health, And, you know, this has received a lot of attention over the past two decades. Nursing has a strong history of recognizing that health must be considered within the context of people's lives and living conditions. Florence Nightingale was one of the first to recognize and address the connection between health and environmental conditions, such as ventilation, clean air and water, noise pollution. Similarly, Lillian Wald also recognized that the effects of both environment and social conditions on health and poverty, and was involved in using epidemiological methods to support promoting health-promoting social policies. Nurses continue to lead efforts in addressing inequities and social determinants of health, and are well posed to address social, economic, and other environmental conditions on health. The inclusion of community and population lens in NINR's strategic plan acknowledges these contributions and is a call for nursing research to identify and test innovative solutions to address our most pressing health concerns within populations and communities. So now I want to share a couple research examples that relate to the social determinants of health that incorporate population level approaches. So the first example will explore the intersection of social and physical strategies for reducing community level crime and violence. So in 2011, the University of Michigan Youth Violence Prevention Center was funded by the CDC to implement a multi-level intervention to change rates of violence and violence-related injury in Flint, Michigan. This community academic partnership sought to capitalize on existing community resources and evidence-based approaches using a socio-ecological approach to change. The project included six evidence-based strategies to reduce youth violence and injury at the individual, interpersonal, and community level. One of these interventions was community-engaged greening, or clean and green, and I'm going to focus on that community-level intervention today. So crime prevention through environmental design, and I'll refer to this as CEPTED going forward, is an approach for creating safe neighborhood conditions. There's been quite a bit of research done on this application of the physical application of CEPTED principles for reducing crime and promoting community safety. Like I said, CEPTED has a set of design principles, which you can see here on the left. That communicate that an area is owned, cared for, and inappropriate for crime. And it includes some of these components. Maintenance, which involves improving the physical appearance of a space to indicate stewardship and investment. Surveillance involves clearing sight lines so residents can look out for their neighbors. Lighting, which ensures that an area is well lit so residents feel safe to move about their neighborhood. And social management, which involves designing spaces so that they are inviting positive use, such as building a playground, creating a community garden, or installing a soccer field. However, CEPTED has been criticized for being too focused on physical change without sufficient attention to community context and resident engagement. And more recently, researchers, including the group I work with, have been exploring how community-engaged CEPTED or social CEPTED approach that incorporates resident involvement in the process may help transform neighborhoods. So social CEPTED is a participatory crime prevention process that engages residents in planning and implementing the physical CEPTED changes. The idea behind social CEPTED is that if you involve people from the neighborhood in applying CEPTED and improving and reclaiming vacant or neglected spaces, they will care enough about their environment to take care of those spaces, to take care of each other, and to help create the thriving conditions for safe and healthy neighborhoods. This creates an environment that residents will want to defend and take care of, hence the idea of the defensible spaces. So when STEP-TED changes are implemented in a community-engaged fashion that incorporates both physical and social STEP-TED strategies, we expect to see positive neighborhood transformation through key pathways. STEP-TED will create healthier built environments that invite positive activities and support health. There's improved physical conditions may have a direct effect on physical and mental health. STEP-TED may improve the safety of communities by reducing opportunities for crime and violence. And engaging residents in the process of improving their communities may empower residents with social and psychological resources to feel better and improve neighborhood conditions. Our team first examined community engaged or social STEP-TED in 2011 as part of our CDC funded Youth Violence Prevention Center, like I mentioned. We sought to understand the effects of community care on vacant lots, on police reported crime incidents. We partnered with the Genesee County Land Bank Clean and Green Program, a program in which community groups can receive a small amount of funds to care for vacant lots in their neighborhood. This includes activities such as mowing and trash removal. We compared the incidence of violent crime among 216 residential streets in Flint, Michigan that contained vacant lots maintained by the Clean and Green neighborhood groups to segments within unmaintained vacant lot areas. Intervention lots cared for by the Clean and Green groups received regular mowing and trash removal, while the control lots received no maintenance. So we were interested in really looking at differences in crime rates and specifically violent crimes. So we found that street segments with vacant lots maintained by the Clean and Green program neighborhood groups had nearly 40% fewer assaults and violent crimes than street segments with vacant lots receiving no maintenance across a 4-year period. So we're still really interested in community engagement piece though of greening. And we really wanted to understand if community engagement in lot care was really the key ingredient in our finding. So to do that, in 2016, the Michigan Youth Violence Prevention Center again received CDC funding to continue to examine community engaged greening. Specifically, how much community engagement in the greening activities made a difference in crime and violence. We were in two communities, both post-industrial cities, cities that had been prosperous with well-paying industrial jobs, but loss of industry contributed to loss of employment, declining populations, and abandonment, disinvestment, and physical deterioration, which all increased the risk for community violence. So we had a quasi-experimental design with three arms. The first arm was greening kind of program activities. So community and youth engaged parcel improvement and mowing. The second arm was professional mowing. And then the third arm was no organized mowing, which simply meant that we were unaware of any organized mowing efforts or efforts to maintain the parcels in those areas. We found that areas that had greening activities of any kind, so whether they were maintained by the community and youth engaged mowing program or the professional mowing, had reductions in overall violent crime and youth violent crime compared to the no treatment condition. But areas that had community engaged greening had greater deductions in overall violent crime and youth violent crime compared to the professional mowing conditions. So we found that active participation of residents and ongoing attention to the areas that occurred through community engaged greening did have a greater impact on reducing violent crime, but it also had other benefits. So the community engaged kind of STEP-TED activities contributed towards building social and psychological resources for neighborhood transformation. It increased positive street activity. It increased a sense of community and collective efficacy. Community engagement in neighborhood improvement really enhanced community empowerment. Community engaged SEPTED that combines physical revitalization with community engagement and control, community engagement and control creates a potent synergy for promoting safe and healthy neighborhoods. The second example is a multi-level behavioral health study that incorporate activities related to individual behavior, healthcare access, and the social environment. Ample evidence supports the efficacy of prevention and treatment programs for substance use disorders, but less is known about how to effectively implement evidence-based services in low-resource communities such as Flint. In response, we propose to study the implementation of multiple evidence-based strategies to reduce behavioral health disparities and improve family resilience in the Flint community by building multiple levels of support. So Strengthening Families Program, a community university initiative, was one of the core projects of the Flint Center for Health Equity Solutions, a National Institute of Minority Health and Health Disparities funded transdisciplinary collaborative center. The overarching goals of Strengthening Families Program was to ensure that effective substance use disorder and prevention programs were available to all families throughout the Flint community, to increase individual and family capacity to respond to crisis and promote self-efficacy, and to reduce the stigma around substance misuse and treatment seeking. We approached this in two phases. The first phase focused on assessing the needs and strengths of Flint-serving organizations and the community at large, including barriers to access of behavioral health services. We did this through a combination of organizational assessments and key informant interviews. We used this information then in our second phase, which was to implement and evaluate our multi-level intervention. Today, I'm really just going to talk about the second phase. So we proposed evidence-based strategies at these multiple levels. At the individual level, we're peer recovery coaching. Peer recovery coaches are individuals who have lived experience of recovery, and they offer support to enroll community members in substance use treatment. They support them during the treatment process and the transition out of treatment and back to kind of maintaining recovery as they kind of leave care. Peer recovery coaches receive specialized training and services are supported by Medicaid. At the family level, we offered a strengthening and supported Strengthening Families Program, an evidence-based substance use prevention program for families with children ages 10 to 14. The program focuses on improving parenting skills, children's mental health and substance misuse, and family resilience. At the community level, we had a multimedia campaign with information and messages about the effectiveness and availability of substance use care in the community to increase usage and reduce stigma. The multimedia campaign included social messaging through Facebook and Twitter, a local radio program, and messages on like bus bench ads, kind of like billboard ads, kind of with these similar messaging. Finally, at the state and kind of policy level, we engaged in activities that advocated for and supported the creation of a sustainable system for recovery services that were third-party billable. So I don't have community-level outcomes to share with you today for this project. During the time of our project, several factors came into play that kind of create some challenges with us looking at outcomes. For one, COVID happened. So COVID occurred kind of mid-project, which we know changed people's lives in many ways, but also changed care and delivery and reimbursement related to substance use treatment services. So telehealth and telephonic services became much more billable. And there was a significant increase in substance use and mental health treatment facilities providing telemedicine services. And so while now in 2023, some of that allowance has gone away, telehealth is still allowable for peer recovery coach services. There have also been movements, larger movements at the national level, including increases of federal funding for substance use care and recovery services. So the interplay between the activities we were engaged in, these and other factors make it difficult for us to disentangle the true outcomes of our work. So currently we are examining changes in access to care over time. However, we have seen some increases in an acceptance of peer recovery coaching. For example, at the start of our project, peer recovery coaches at our community partner organization provided 460 coaching hours in that first quarter between their outpatient and residential programs. Today, or in this just past quarter, this is now 5 to 6 years later, peer recovery services at our community partner organization have increased, with PRCs providing over 23,000 coaching units in that quarter. So we don't think this is unique to just our single community partner organization. It appears that while in our initial key informant interviews in that first phase of our project, that agencies suggested they weren't quite sure what to do with peer recovery coaches, this has changed. And I think organizations in Flint have really figured out how to incorporate them in as part of their substance use care team. So even though I don't have concrete community level outcomes to share with you today for this project, I highlight the project for several reasons. First, I think it showcases a multi-level approach to addressing a health-related outcome within a geographic community. And this is a community that has been disproportionately affected by health disparities and the impact of substance abuse. Second, I think it's important to understand that these kind of approaches can be challenging. Understanding the impact of some of the approaches at the policy level, at a community level, can also be influenced by other things going on that are outside of your control. So unlike when you do a clinical randomized control trial, you lose some of the control you have when you're studying these more, more real world approaches. However, I think these real world approaches and understanding how these might impact health equity and reduce health disparities are extremely important and will move the bar forward significantly. So now I want to just provide a few thoughts on nursing science and research opportunities into the future. So we know a fair amount of research has been done on mid-level and downstream determinants of health, things like education, neighborhood conditions, access to care, and we know their relationship to health outcomes and disparities. But I think what we need to focus on and spend more time looking at is how do more upstream social determinants of health, how does governance and policy shape pathways that lead to health disparities? And what are the mechanisms and pathways between various social determinants of health? And how do they lead to these health disparities? So considering my first example, what other health outcomes may be improved through the use of environmental design? With environmental design, we also found that there were other positive outcomes related to community engaged SEPTED activity, increases in community efficacy and connection with community members increases in a feeling of kind of neighborhood safety, and how might those things also play into kind of improving other health outcomes? You know, we could think about the kind of that social septed aspect of kind of the environmental design as an enhancement or a protective factor. And, you know, what other protective factors or mechanisms might reduce the effect of social determinants of health. So as Dr. Zink also mentioned in my introduction, I was appointed by the CDC to be part of the Community Preventative Services Task Force in 2020, an independent panel of experts. And we review evidence and issues and issue findings and recommendations for interventions that improve population health. The Community Guide is the website where we share kind of our findings and recommendations. This is a wonderful resource for organizations and communities interested in evidence-based programs and strategies that support health. But I think sometimes what people may not realize is that we also, in issuing these recommendations, we talk about what works, but we also identify areas of insufficient evidence or evidence gaps. And I think this is a place to also look at, you know, what we still need to understand. And these can inform kind of future research. And so often we don't always have a clear view about some of the community-based interventions and what works for different groups and under what conditions. So I think that is a space that we could continue to better understand that. And then there is a role for continuing to look at multi-level approaches to address some of our other kind of pertinent and important health challenges. I do think though, and there's been quite a bit also of conversation around the need when we are looking at multi-level approaches and especially policy approaches, that we wanna be careful to consider groups potentially with fewer resources. Now, my examples were both really in settings and focused on kind of low resource kind of populations, but we need to keep an eye that our kind of policies and maybe other approaches aren't unintentionally increasing health disparities or health inequities. Finally, I think, I think there's also an opportunity for us to harness data that is already available, whether it's through electronic health records or population data that maybe can help us understand the effects of policy. In some ways, I think about kind of this as, you know, kind of natural experiments. Are there ways that we can compare different kind of policies in different states and how they impact health outcomes, or differences in reimbursement or payment methods and their effect on health outcomes. So I think there's opportunities, like I said, kind of just in policy changes that maybe are occurring to try to better understand what they mean for populations, what they mean for kind of health inequity or health, hopefully health equity. You know, I list here an example of direct cash payments to families with children. There's a lot of evidence that suggests that this is an effective way to reduce child poverty and improve health and well-being. But what are some of the other maybe benefits of economic support? Are there other benefits outside of just improving, you know, maybe the mother and child or child poverty that kind of result from these kinds of policies and support mechanisms? So finally, I would be remiss as an educator not to mention training. And how do we, you know, and think about how we prepare the next generation of nurse scientists to examine these complex issues, to think about population health and kind of push us ahead in improving the health of kind of populations. I listed a few things that I think are important for us to be including as we prepare, you know, doctorally trained students, kind of data analytics skills. We know health information technology. I talked a lot about multi-level interventions, you know, kind of providing those experiences and those knowledge, I think will be critical for the next generation of nurse scientists. And I'd like to thank you for having me today.
Thank you. That was great. Thank you so much. So I would like to invite Dr. Kuehnert to share his perspective with us. Dr. Kuehnert, the floor is yours.
Thanks so much, Dr. Zink. I really appreciate it. And it's good to be a part of this today. If we could go to the next slide, please. So as a practitioner in community and public health for the past 40 years, I'm really deeply appreciative of NINR's new strategic plan and the use of these lenses, the priority of these lenses around social determinants as well as community and population health. So what I hope to bring to the discussion today in the webinar are a set of reflections that really are for your consideration as you think about research in community and population health at this time. So I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about the context of the current moment and particularly the impact of the COVID pandemic on community and population health and the identification of three key policy and practice areas that kind of flow from the experience, particularly with COVID. And then third, I just want to kind of point you to some of the unique data that we at FAB, the Public Health Accreditation Board, have and can make available to you as researchers if you're interested in exploring some of these questions. Next slide. So in November of 2021, NPR and the Chan School of Public Health at Harvard conducted a national poll on public attitudes toward public health. And this was really looking at all of this in the COVID, in the height of the COVID experience. The true headline of this study, in terms of trying to get to a summary, is that public health has never been so visible as it has been these past 3+ years, and yet simultaneously both misunderstood and mistrusted. The loss of trust in public health has persisted with subsequent polls. So there was one done early this year that showed that just a bare majority of US adults trust the public health will effectively manage and respond to the next pandemic. Next slide. So the loss of trust is part and parcel of the many losses that we experienced as a result of the pandemic. Whether we look at the staggering economic losses, the toll of mental, emotional, and physical suffering, or the absolute numbers of lives lost. And of course, so much of these losses were preventable. The US performed by pretty much every measure. Its performance was worse than peer high-income countries across the globe. And this is documented very extensively in a new publication that was just released last month called Lessons from the COVID War. For all of us that care deeply about population and community health, our country's response to the COVID pandemic and the resulted losses are going to shape the way that we do our work, whether it's in practice or in research, for decades to come. Next slide, please. So as I reflected on the current situation and kind of looked at some of the literature, three kind of key buckets of issues rose to the top in terms of things that have to be considered in terms of policy and practice as we think about what we're doing with community and population health research. So I want to just kind of touch on some of the key components of each of these three, and then again, kind of point toward some resources that we at FAB might be able to provide to you to address them. Next slide. So the issue of trust in any kind of intervention that we are looking at is really critical. And I think some of Dr. Stoddard's remarks kind of pointed to this as well. There's three factors that are affecting trust right now as we come out of this pandemic experience. First of all, it's important for us to recognize that there's larger social trends that have been going on for many decades that kind of set us up for the issue of trust during the pandemic. So going back to the 1960s and going to the present day, we see that trust in government has dropped significantly over these decades. And this was before COVID. And then importantly, the social connections within our neighborhoods and our communities have also been eroding. And this is resulting in a lack of trust in neighbors to do the right thing during emergencies. A second key component of trust has been the historic health inequities that have affected so many of our communities. So for example, Black maternal and infant mortality. And these health inequities certainly predated COVID. They've continued through COVID. And in fact, these disparities in health outcomes, just looking at COVID, kind of replicated the inequities that we've seen for so many decades. And then the third factor that's affecting trust is the incredible amount of pandemic mis and disinformation that occurred. And it's been a truly pernicious feature of the COVID response in our country. And it's not only kind of innocent, perhaps, misinformation, if there is such a thing, but oftentimes deliberate disinformation that's driven largely for political reasons. And it results in real world consequences. So one of the examples is that the disinformation campaigns really affected COVID booster uptake and resulted in an estimate of between 100 and 150,000 preventable deaths. Next slide. A second key set of issues that have arisen out of the pandemic, and it's certainly true in healthcare as well, but looking specifically at community and population health and public health, is around the public health workforce. And there's three key factors that are not entirely unique to public health, but some aspects of them are. So first and foremost, I think recent surveys that have been done of the public health workforce show very, very high levels of stress, burnout, and actual PTSD. What we're seeing also within these surveys of the health workforce, public health workforce, is that there's currently a very high vacancy rate, as well as in a national survey last year, a stated intention of public health workers, about 25% of public health workers saying they plan to leave the workforce within the next year. And this stress and burnout, this vacancy rate, this intention to leave percentage, all is on top of an existing deficit of what a study that we did, funded by the de Beaumont Foundation and CDC, estimated to be a deficit of 80,000 public health workers. And the deficit really did not look at the full range of public health services, but really looked at the bare minimum to deliver these essential public health services. And then finally, another component of the workforce is leadership turnover, where in many, many states across the country, we have between 20 and 40% of local health officers, the leaders of city and county health departments, turning over either through retirement, forced resignation, or just choice to leave during the pandemic. Next slide. And the third bucket is really looking at a set of systems and partnership issues that, again, arose through the kind of crucible of the experience of the pandemic, but oftentimes were features of community and population health systems before the pandemic. So the first one is, you know, the incredible need for real-time data analytics and action across sectors. We don't have existing a robust network that connects health departments, healthcare, and social service agencies in order to do real-time surveillance, planning and distribution of resources, or sharing emerging innovative best practices in real time. In terms of resources and policy in this area, we have a lack of what people have called peacetime policy and pre-positioning of resources and plans across multiple levels of government and across sectors. And these lack of resources and planning really were highly illustrated during the pandemic. And so, for example, resulted in a lack of practical toolkits for reopening schools and businesses. And then the last issue in this area of systems and partnerships is the issue of governance. We have a public health system and governance structure that really was built in the 1890s, not the 1990s, the 1890s. And there is a lack of executive function for health security that is at a national level. So both preparedness and response are really put at risk. Next slide. So I don't like to highlight a lot of issues and challenges without bringing solutions or potential solutions to the table. This is just a little bit about my organization, and we are, as Dr. Zink indicated in the introduction, a national accrediting body for state, local, tribal, army, and territorial health departments. And in November of this past year, we were selected by CDC so that we could be one of the three national partners to support governmental public health systems in addressing the issues that I highlighted. So as part of our work, we're gathering large amounts of data that are organized according to some key conceptual frameworks that I'll just go through very, very quickly as we wrap up. Next slide. So we have two major conceptual frameworks that guide our work. One is the essential services of public health that really looks at all of the things that have to be done on a community level to prevent and promote health. And then foundational public health services. And that's a model that looks specifically at governmental public health services. Next slide. So our accreditation standards are aligned completely with the structure of the essential public health services model. Next slide. And what this does is provide us with a very robust, large, and varied set of data that we can make available to researchers that are interested in a wide variety of research questions, especially those that kind of arise from those three key concerns that I raised today about trust, workforce, and systems and partnerships. Next slide. So I just want to close by saying that we are going to have an additional database that's going to be coming soon. It's called Public Health Lift. And if we go to the next slide, forgive the alphabet soup here, but just to give you an indication that if you're interested in public health services and systems research in particular, there's going to be a one-stop shop, if you will, for data that really look at all that we have around public health infrastructure, systems, and workforce. And probably that will be available in 2024. Next slide. So I'm going to hand this back to Dr. Zank, and thank you so much for the opportunity to be with you today.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Kuehnert. I really want to thank both of the speakers today. So let's fit in a couple of questions. One, you hit on community and the importance of community involvement and influence and say. So could you both give us just a couple of tips as we approach research that, you know, engages community in a meaningful way of what are best practices and what can make those partnerships truly a partnership and successful?
So I think, you know, both of the examples I gave were very, you know, kind of grounded in community partnerships and even longer term community partnerships. And so I do think starting from the beginning, and working and trying to work with community organizations or community partners early on in the planning is really helpful to understand, what the community needs, what the community sees in, as important, and to kind of develop those relationships and then to, you know, be kind of working with them then throughout the process. From kind of starting to think about an idea and maybe a project to, you know, kind of, you know, getting funding to do it, to evaluating it. And we co-write publications, then we include them in our manuscripts. So, I mean, I think it's, you know, the best practices in including them in kind of all aspects of it. But there are times that doesn't always work, but I think engaging the community partners early is really important though.
I would totally agree with Dr. Stoddard and would just emphasize that if we're going to move the needle on health inequities, community engagement is absolutely key. And I would just point to again that the fact that governmental public health cannot do this by itself, certainly, this needs to be a partnership, multi-sectoral effort. And our data that we have about community health assessments and community health improvement plans can be a rich source for your research to really explore what are the success factors in community engagement and moving the needle on population health outcomes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good.
Yeah. Good. Sorry, Dr. Zank. Just to, add, I think the other piece to think about is also sustainability then. And, I think through engaging, you know, with your community partners and thinking about that, you know, as part of the process too, is important for really kind of longer term than, kind of program kind of uptake and sustainability long term.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the importance of community engagement too, Paul, with, you know, what you pointed out about trust, as well, which is so critical. I can't believe how fast this hour has flown by. I'll have to stop us there. I do want to point out, I imagine both speakers are happy to take your questions if you reach out to them by email, and we're happy at NINR to make those connections if you can't easily find the speakers' emails. And also say there have been some questions about NINR's interests in certain areas, and I would encourage everyone to reach out to our program staff at any time with questions that you have. We welcome those. So next slide, please. I need to make sure we get to the continuing education credits. So they are available. So you can scan the QR code on this slide for a link to a short survey in order to receive your certificate. We do want to thank FAES for supporting our mission and lecture series by helping us with the evaluations and these continuing education certificates. Next slide. Importantly, I do want to thank our speakers today, Dr. Stoddard and Kuehnert. We are so grateful to you for sharing your knowledge and your expertise with us. So thank you for joining us. Please stay tuned, everyone, to our website at ninr.nih.gov for the latest updates at NINR. And again, here is a an email address so that if you have questions for us at NINR, for the speakers, we're happy to get your questions answered. So with that, I will need to close us out. Thank you so much, Dr. Kuehnert and Dr. Stoddard. And thank you, everyone, for joining us.
Thank you.